when we are in the process of holding national election for the parliament, India is facing a very critical situation. There seems to be very little choice before the country. The fascist forces led by Narendra Modi of the BJP have gained unprecedented momentum. And this they have achieved by mere propaganda of a typically Goebbelian's character. This propaganda is indulging in rhetorics of a totally negative nature, has no substance or programmatic elements, and it is being repeated meeting after meeting to an extent where unsuspecting and some self-interested voters have come to believe in that. There doesn't seem to be any force in the field which is capable of arresting this juggernaut. It is futile to repose any faith in this regard on the Congress Party, because the Congress Party had lost all its credibility because of the rampant corruption that its leaders have indulged in for personal benefit during the past several years. The manner in which they have violated the rule of law, the manner in which they have encouraged mafia raj all over the country, and the manner in which they have made promises in the social field to the minority groups and have gone back on it when it has come to implementation. I think even on the issue of secularism, though at the level of rhetoric they support it, as do several other parties like the Socialist Party of Mulayam Singh Yadav or BSP, but in actual practice and belief, one can hardly identify anybody in the Congress Party who can be regarded as genuine and true, except to some extent Sonia Gandhi. It is a huge indictment of the Congress Party. I think the other forces, political forces, which used to play a balancing role in the Indian politics until the recent years, have also reduced themselves to insignificance in the Indian political scene, partly because over the years they have lost touch with the reality, and instead of paying attention to the real problems of the country, they have indulged in ideological rhetoric which have become outdated in the rest of the world, and in the process they have lost touch with the domestic problems and the real people here. So we have a very dim prospect before us. The real fear of the rise of fascism in the country, which can have far-reaching consequences, apart from leading to dictatorship, limitations on freedom, threats to the life of the people, to extinguishing freedom for all but those who follow their ideology. This is the surest recipe for the division of the nation and the splitting of the nation. And this is going to be a very important factor which will come in the way of India's development, India's progress, and India occupying a rightful place in the Committee of Nations. It is very clear for me that any right-thinking Indian cannot vote for a party which is led by a leader who was at the helm of a state government and one of the most heinous crimes against one of our minority groups was committed in the country, and who has nothing to offer to the country except rhetoric, negativism, and threats, and empty words. So first and foremost is that any right-thinking person should not vote for this party. The second thing is that short of alternative, and as I said, the Congress does not provide an alternative, most unfortunately, we should vote for any candidate who has the chance of defeating these forces, and any candidate which essentially which believes in the essential unity and secular character of India enshrined in the Indian Constitution. Well, I find it very difficult to believe their claims to secularism, because the manner in which they have acted until now indicates that this is only a rhetoric. And in actual practice, when this safeguarding the interest of the minorities and other ethnic groups are concerned, they look at it purely from the narrow angle of the political interest rather than from the broad view of Indian citizenship which is in our constitution. But I think we have no way out but to take their words at face value. And if some of them win a sizable number of seats, then there could still be a possibility of forces which are at least formally committed to secularism forming government, and that would be far more preferable, and in any case the last remaining hope for withstanding this challenge to India's unity and cohesion. And otherwise it is going to be a longer struggle.